Getting proper mental health care can help you feel more like you. That's why Cerebral offers convenient access to online mental health services, including therapy and medication management. Cerebral's diverse clinician team can help with anxiety, insomnia, relationship issues, workplace stress, and more. You can schedule and communicate with your care team through Cerebral's mobile app and attend your sessions from the comfort of your own home. Get started with or without insurance. Plus, you can use your FSA or HSA. Start your first month for 50% off at Cerebral.com/ACAST.
ACAST powers the world's best podcasts. Here's a show that we recommend.
What would you say if I told you there's a book that can teach you how to win The Bachelor?
What would you say if I told you producers caught multiple finalists reading that book in this season that's currently airing?
What would you say if I told you the producers don't want anyone to know that their show has been compromised?
How do we know all this? We wrote that book.
I'm Lizzie Pace.
And I'm Chad Colchin.
We're the authors of How to Win the Bachelor and the hosts of the Game of Roses podcast, a bi-weekly podcast where we break down all the biggest plays, errors, and MVPs in the game of reality television.
Listen to Game of Roses wherever you get your podcasts and go to howtowinthebachelor.com to get our book.
ACAST helps creators launch, grow, and monetize their podcasts everywhere. ACAST.com.
Hello, it's Dave here. I'm with my wife, Kathy.
Hello.
We are sat on the couch. So for anyone who's joining us for the first time, our podcast is normally us walking home from the cinema. But we do a thing called the Cinemeter, which is essentially an excuse to stay at home.
And sit on the sofa.
Yes.
And we are approximately a meter from our TV, which is where the name came from. Now, we're probably a bit further than a meter, but Cine 3 meter didn't sound very good, did it?
I don't think it's 3 meters either. What do you want to get out the measuring tape?
No. And so what
I'm going to say it's about 2.5.
2.5, okay. Cine 2.5 meter. And what we're doing tonight is a Halloween special. We put a poll on Twitter. There were 4 horror movies, of which I'd never seen because I'm not really into horror movies. It's not a genre that I really go for because I get scared really easily. So the 4 movies were, Dave, drumroll.
So we had the Exorcist, Halloween, The Wicker Man. We hadn't specified the original or the Nicolas Cage version, which a lot of people pointed out, or Rosemary's Baby.
I wanted Rosemary's Baby.
You were for Rosemary. Yeah. Rosemary's Baby was the least popular. The Exorcist is the winner with 37% of the vote, and we had nearly 200 votes, so thanks everyone who took part in that Twitter poll.
Yes, thank you. But now so, I don't want to watch this because it's like one of these movies that... I've seen some sort of new reboot or remake of it. I don't know what that was.
Oh, they did like prequels or sequels?
I've seen
to
something.
Like, I know, in the last 10 years?
I've not seen the original. And secondly, I've seen it parodied so much. So I would say I'm not particularly looking forward to watching something that I feel I know. You know that way when you haven't seen it, but you feel like you've seen it.
It was supposed to be one of the greatest movies of all time.
I know.
I should clarify as well, I haven't seen this either. So this is actually... I hadn't seen 2 of the movies on the list. I haven't seen Rosemary's Baby either. So it's going to be a good, interesting experience for both of us.
So.
This is a classic horror movie. And apparently, according to the Blu-ray cover here, the scariest film of all time.
I reckon the scariest film of all time is The Ring.
What, the, which one?
The remake of The Ring.
The Gus Van Sant one.
Yes, that was one of the most petrifying.
That's a good movie.
It's probably the last time I actually saw a horror film. I'm so terrified.
Really? You're really not into
it? No, I'm really not into
it. Oh, you're not going to be good with this at all.
No. I mean, I hope we don't scream in terror and wake the baby.
We should say thank you to Lee Gant from the What's the Point Paranormal podcast, a former guest of this show, who lent us this DVD.
Yes, thank you, Lee.
It's a Blu-ray.
It's a Blu-ray. And it's
unopened.
So he's very interested in it.
Lee's just got a big back catalogue of stuff. He told me when he gave me this that he actually watched The Exorcist the other night on Amazon Prime, which I think is a testament to the fact that Blu-rays and DVDs are dead.
Yes. Okay, but we need to go because I'm tired and this is a long...
No, I'm gonna open the Blu-ray live on the podcast. It's like an unboxing video on YouTube, except even more boring.
It's even more boring. Okay,
because you can't even see...
Don't do that.
...what I'm doing. Okay, it's open.
So boring, are you kidding me? I'm actually going to turn this thing off, come on.
All right, okay. So, the back. So, it was winner of 2 Academy Awards.
Mm-hmm.
I nominated for an additional 8.
Wow. What did it win?
It doesn't say. There are two
ends. Wow. Full of research as always. Dave's actually blushed. You've gone red. You're so embarrassed.
I'm very embarrassed. Just... I don't know what it won. What is this? A film podcast? There are two. Oh shit. There's two discs here.
Oh.
We've got the extended director's cut or the original theatrical version.
Which one is shorter?
What do you? Of course, you're going to say which one is shorter.
One, yeah, shorter one.
Well, what do you think? The director's cut. It's rare that a director's cut is shorter than a theatrical.
Yeah.
It's not like the director's like, oh, I hated that scene.
Yeah.
I want less.
Okay, but can we wrap this up now? Because I'm really tired.
All right, fine. Okay. Let's go. We're going for the theatrical cut of The Exorcist. We'll see you in approximately 122 minutes.
Okay, bye.
Bye.
Somewhere between science and superstition, there is another world. The world of darkness. Nobody expected it. Nobody believed it. And nothing could stop it.
There are no experts. You probably know as much about possession as most priests. Look, your daughter doesn't say she's a demon. She says she's the devil himself.
I'm telling you that thing upstairs isn't my daughter.
All right, so we have finished The Exorcist, and we are now joined by a special guest, our son Oscar.
Yes, who's dressed as a pumpkin.
He is for Halloween.
for watching The Exorcist.
He looks ridiculous.
Yes.
He joined us for the second half of this.
Yes, he thoroughly enjoyed it.
He loved it.
Yeah.
I mean, any time he did look at the screen, he showed mild passing interest, I would say.
So we both really enjoyed this movie, which was cool. Yeah.
It's a great movie.
Yeah, it was really good.
It's kind of a... I don't know, do enough people know about this movie?
Yeah, I know. And you may have all heard that it was in the news a couple of weeks ago because It, the new Stephen King adaptation, beat the 40-year record this held of being the highest grossing horror movie of all time.
All right.
Yeah, so this had been like over 400 million adjusted for inflation.
Global.
And It is now already surpassed 500. I had been reading about this a couple of weeks ago. Why is it depressing?
I haven't seen It.
Well, they're both based on books.
I guess.
Big franchises. It's not particularly... Seems like what?
I don't know. That seems like a bit... By all accounts, it's like it's pretty good, that movie, but it's not like anything special.
Yeah, well, look, I'd say this movie...
is something special.
I would say this movie's really enjoyable, and what I liked about it was... First of all,
really enjoyable.
What I'm going to say is the spoilers up front on this. If you haven't seen it, I'm pretty sure you can guess what it's about.
Yeah.
And it's 40 years old. So what I mainly liked about this was that it was a little bit scary, but not jump scary, which is what I don't like. So it was more psychologically disturbing. Even at that, because...
That's more scary, I would say.
Yeah, but because this movie...
You don't like the jolts, is it?
No, I don't like jolts, but because this movie has been parodied and lampooned, and I've seen, like, as I was watching it, I kept thinking, have I seen this movie? Haven't I seen this movie? Because I've seen so many clips of it at this point. So much of it was familiar to me that just really lessened the impact.
And
so if we'd seen it in the 70s in the cinema, I'm sure it would have been terrifying.
And I've seen so many movies that have just basically either been inspired by this or just lifted things wholesale.
Yeah.
Particularly, I mean, there have been so many other Exorcist
Exactly.
movies. I mean, The Exorcism of Emily Rose is one that comes to mind.
So I think basically it's been dulled for us, so the impact is not the same as if we had seen it at the time. Now, we were both shocked at a scene with her and her mother.
With the crucifix.
The crucifix. So she was
stabbing herself
with the crucifix.
And
then
pretty much all the language that comes from Linda Blair is...
Yeah, the language from
really
the girl
shocking.
Is really shocking. The sexual stuff was really shocking to me. And then as a whole... First of all, like, I'm quite tired at the moment, and it was like pushing 2 hours length. It did not feel that long to me. I really enjoyed that there was a really slow build up, so we were getting to know the characters in their own right, not together, which you don't often see for that long in a movie, that the characters don't meet.
Yeah, they don't meet till about an hour and 15 minutes in.
Yeah, really interesting.
And the actual exorcist himself doesn't show up until the end.
Yeah, so we always, so yeah, and I really enjoyed the priest characters. I liked the setting that the mother was a movie star and has this kind of glamorous life, and then it all goes to shit.
Yeah.
I really liked it.
Ellen Burstyn was amazing.
Yeah, she's really good. She
just, and I thought it was particularly interesting watching this as a new parent, because I felt it, a lot of that really hit home for me from her character. Just the panic and the absolute, like she was going to any length. The increasing frustration and fear that she was experiencing was really profound, I thought. She sold it really well. She just unravels.
She sold it really well, but I was also thinking, if your child, honest to God, looked like this, I mean, social services would be called. Like, she was spewing...
Well, who's
going to
call social services?
But multiple doctors saw her. She was spewing green stuff. She was chained to a bed, being fed through, like, fluids through her nose.
Yeah.
It was truly horrifying.
But that's illness. That's not anything the mother had caused, right?
No, but I'm just saying, if somebody saw her, she'd legions on her face. She was bleeding everywhere. She was screaming out sexual language. Like, it was just really funny that that's what the daughter was doing.
Funny?
And, like, in terms of... And the doctors are all like, oh, just get an exorcist.
No, like, to be fair...
The doctors weren't into it at all.
No, no, the doctors... I thought that was really interesting when she's got this team of psychologists. Nobody can do anything. And that they suggest the exorcism. But I thought it was interesting that they see it as a sort of, if the patient believes in it, and the then it sort of has a placebo effect.
Yeah, that was interesting. And so the setting overall, I think the setting was quite cool in that they were staying in this place because they were on location for a film. Now, interesting that Linda Blair was nominated for an Oscar, because I don't see that it was a particularly great performance. To me, it was down to the makeup. And also, I mean, blatantly, it's not her voice saying the stuff that when she's possessed. Hoping that's not the child saying that stuff, and it sounded like a male actor or an older woman anyway. So what? How can you be Oscar nominated?
I think it's a woman actually delivers those lines.
But how can you be Oscar nominated for that performance? I don't believe that that's something that should be Oscar nominated, when the majority of your performance is prosthetics and somebody else's voice.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah, but isn't it? I mean, she's still at the core of the performance. The prosthetics and everything else is just sort of the padding.
No, it's,
I mean,
all about the prosthetics.
Getting proper mental health care can help you feel more like you. That's why Cerebral offers convenient access to online mental health services, including therapy and medication management. Cerebral's diverse clinician team can help with anxiety, insomnia, relationship issues, workplace stress, and more. You can schedule and communicate with your care team through Cerebral's mobile app and attend your sessions from the comfort of your own home. Get started with or without insurance. Plus, you can use your FSA or HSA. Start your first month for 50% off at Cerebral.com/ACAST.
Are you kidding me? Like, that was...
Yeah, but she's still
all about
at the
makeup.
Center of it.
She's it delivering could have been anyone. It could have been anyone. I don't buy that she should have been Oscar nominated for it. And I really enjoyed the younger priest who looked like Gabriel Byrne.
Yeah, Jason Miller is the actor's name.
And also looked like the Italian Stallion.
He looked a lot. He could have played Rocky.
Yeah, he could have played Rocky.
He's excellent. I thought he was a real standout in this. Just real, so subtle. And you again, like, you see him just slowly unravel. I didn't really know a lot about the plot, but I liked that he's a man of science and faith. Like, he very much tackles this from the skeptic's point of view. He's a psychologist.
Well, he went to Harvard Medical School. What's he wasting his time in the Catholic Church living in a cell?
But he said that he was a priest first and then became a psychologist.
I know, I'm just saying, like, he could be having a decent lifestyle for himself instead of living in that disgusting room that he lives in.
Also, I was reading up on this because we actually did 5 minutes of research here, which is more 5 minutes more than we normally do. And the actor himself studied to become a priest for 3 years.
Oh wow, that is interesting.
Which was interesting, and he died in 2001.
Oh, and then we did.
He was super.
Yeah, he's really good, and we did enjoy when the music came on because we both. Oh yeah, that's the music. Do 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 do.
Yeah, really iconic music, which we were all familiar with before we turned it on, but it barely appears in this.
I know.
I could have said maybe 3 times it showed up.
Yeah, and actually, what do you think of the exorcism scene itself? Oh, there's Oscar.
Oh, you're right off.
I felt like the exorcism scene itself.
You're ignoring me for a podcast.
It could have gone on a bit. Like, it felt like the whole exorcism was over in an hour. in terms of the movie's timeline. And they had teed it up to be more exciting when they said about the older priest.
It takes months.
Yeah, he did one for months. So I'm like, ooh, how long is this going to go on for? Not very long. All done in an evening. Granted, both of them die at the end.
Well, really, the fact that Max von Sydow, who plays the older priest, I forget the guy's name, who is the exorcist, he's kind of barely in it. I think he makes an impact. But this movie should be called The Exorcism.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
It's not about The Exorcist.
Maybe the book's more about it, though. Who knows? But yeah, just at the end, then it seemed really easy, because actually all you need to do for an exorcism is say, take me! Let the devil jump
and
into
and then
you,
jump out the window.
And then you jump out the window, yeah.
It's that easy.
I find that really anticlimactic, and then everyone's right as rain, back to their normal lives
again.
No,
but it was... it was quite chilling when he just loses it and starts, like, punching her.
I thought the whole thing
was really chilling. I found it very... I don't know, was I scared? But I was quite, like, enthralled and upset.
I was interested in it. I really enjoyed it. And it felt like a movie from the 70s. It felt of its time.
Yeah, i.e. brilliant. Because so movies many movies in the 70s.
Yeah,
the movies in the 70s were just better.
I know.
Like this is so confident. And it takes its time. It's slow. There's this whole bit in the beginning in Iraq where they set him up. And he, you know, he's just staring at this demonic statue and he finds things. And it doesn't really have anything to do with the plot. That's just character building. And William Friedkin really takes his time to just let that stuff play out. That would never happen in a movie nowadays. That would be one scene. It would be a quick flashback in Iraq. And then you'd have him seeing the statue. And then you'd have some local speaking to him and he'd say, they call it the statue of Pazazo.
Yeah.
It was a demon that possessed... Like, you get all this... You'd get exposition.
Yeah.
Like, they just spoon-feed you exposition these days.
And it was really, really well cleaned up. So we were watching a HD version that seems to have been done in, what, the early noughties, maybe? That opening scene...
No, this is a Blu-ray.
Oh, this is Blu-ray, okay.
So this would be done very recently.
That
again.
Opening scene looked like it was shot yesterday. It looked so good.
Oh, it's gorgeous. Like,
now, it wasn't quite consistent for the whole DVD because there was parts of it that looked like 70s footage. There was parts of it that looked like right now footage. And I guess they could clean some of it up better than others. Interestingly, I was trying to remember the last time I'd watched a DVD and like a proper Blu-ray DVD.
Yeah, because we had the menu popped up and everything.
Yeah.
And we forgot, because we just stream everything these days. Or we watch it on Sky. So it's...
it looked incredible.
Like, felt like ages. It was so weird to like actually put a disc into the into the player.
So that was quite fun. So I think overall it's really good. And the other difference probably between today and if this movie had been made now versus when it was made, first of all, now I'm no expert on direction and camera work, but I felt like there was a definite overuse of the technique of the director just slowly zooming in on things and then slowly zooming out on things with the camera in a stationary position, to the point where like Ellen Bernstein and the police officer are having coffee and he's literally zooming in and out of them, and I was like, there's nothing to zoom in and out of here. So it lost
it was a suspenseful coffee
it
scene.
Lost its effectiveness.
But that's when she realizes that her daughter is murdered.
But she wasn't just zooming on her face, he was also just zooming in on the whole scene over and over.
All right.
So I felt like that was of its time. And
take
maybe,
that William Friedkin,
maybe not that great. And then the other thing that I definitely think would have happened if this was a modern movie, at the end someone would have had an evil glint in their eye. The implication would have been,
like the
ooh,
demon
the devil's
is gone
still there. Yeah.
To somebody else.
So the fact that it just wrapped up, we were laughing so much because the help, there seemed to be a male kind of older servant, an older lady, and a younger woman. They all hung around the house while this was going on. Now I would be handing in my 2 weeks' notice and getting the hell out of there.
Yeah.
Like hanging out in, and apparently the younger lady who was the babysitter was like dressing her and undressing her because she had seen how she
scrolled.
I wouldn't
be going near her.
Yeah, she scrolled help me on my stomach and that woman saw it. Now how? Have you been undressing this child? She's tied to the bed. Her room is like, what, minus 20 degrees and she's like levitating off the bed and you're in there dressing and undressing her.
Yeah, it's a good job though.
What's she getting paid?
You know, it's good work if you can get it.
Yeah.
I've got a question for you because I found a very interesting fact here.
Okay.
What age do you think Max von Sydow was, or Sydow, I don't know how to say his name, the older priest, when he shot this?
Oof, I don't know, 60?
No, apparently he was 43.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, they've put makeup on him to make him appear 79.
Does not look 43.
Yeah.
I said 60 as a young guess. Assuming you were going
because I was looking at him and thinking, well, first of all, I didn't recognize Max von Sydow. And then I was like, if they got loads of makeup on that guy, and they did. So I don't know why they didn't just hire a 79-year-old. Maybe he's just a man for the job, and they wanted him to be older and more experienced.
Though why they needed a particular actor for a role, I know the title role was The Exorcist, but he was in the movie for all of, what, 15 minutes?
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah.
It reminded me of in Prometheus when Guy Pearce was playing the Weyland Yutani or whoever he was playing, and they aged him up like 40 years for no reason.
Probably because they wanted to go and do that scene in Alien when he was young. Well,
they had prequels, yeah. Yeah, there was all these tie-in clips and all this nonsense. Stanley Kubrick turned this movie down.
Oh, why?
To direct.
Also,
I don't know. I did 5 minutes of research. I didn't go deep. Somebody let us know why Stanley Kubrick turned this down. Ellen Burstyn was injured quite badly in the scene, that horrible scene with the crucifix.
It looked like she was really thrown away. Yeah.
Yeah, apparently that scream that they used was her real scream of pain.
Oh, wow.
And she had a back injury, which hurt affects her to this day.
Wow.
Yeah. Oh, here's another one. The demon's name, never mentioned in the movie, but it's Pazuzu.
Wow. Fascinating stuff. I'm really glad you did this 5 minutes of research. And we should get off, though, because we do have a child to attend to who you can hear gently rocking in the background on his rocking chair.
He's staring at us. Your first podcast, Oscar.
Overall impressions. Good movie to watch for Halloween. I didn't find it particularly scary, but I think it's because we've seen it too many times before. So the impact's been lessened.
It just made me wish that I had been there and seen this in the cinema in 1973. Yeah. Imagine.
I mean, it's shocking stuff. Like, the sexual stuff that girl says to her own mother is shocking.
It's still shocking. Like, we were shocked. It still has power.
It does. And the makeup is so gruesome and, like, so over the top when she just has, like, the green stuff coming out, like, seeping out of her skin. It's so ridiculous looking that it is frightening.
I will say, I thought that the sort of the Blu-ray treatment might have diminished the effect of the makeup.
Yeah, because you could see, like, I could see it was too clear.
It's a bit too clear, and you can see that the vomit is just like slime, and the blood looks a bit fake. So I'd almost would have preferred a bit of blurring around the edges there.
Yeah,
a bit of that Vaseline on the camera effect.
But yeah, so we should get off now. And
yeah, thanks for listening.
Thanks for voting.
Thanks for voting, and please keep tweeting at us or Facebooking and Instagramming. We're at The Cinemile.
Yes, and our email address is thecinemile@gmail.com. And please, this is a perfect time to go and subscribe to us on iTunes if you haven't already, and leave us a review, which would be greatly appreciated.
Happy Halloween!
Bye!
Bye!
Acast powers the world's best podcasts. Here's a show that we recommend.
Hey, I'm Kim Holderness.
And I'm Ben Holderness.
We host the Holderness Family Podcast every Tuesday.
You may know us from the silly videos that we make online.
Or a book about marriage called Everybody Fights.
Or as winners of season 33 of The Amazing Race.
Still can't believe that happened. Listen, we do a lot of stuff, but our podcast is our most favorite thing.
Yeah, because every week we get to sit down face to face, talk to each other about marriage, family, mental health, or just anything that we want to know more about.
Sometimes we have expert interviews, sometimes it's just us, but our goal is to bring some joy and laughter and to your life every week.
Our other goal is that maybe you will learn something as well.
Right, so search the Holderness Family Podcast and check out our most recent episodes. We have one about staying organized with creators of The Home Edit.
And one about being diagnosed with ADHD as an adult.
We hope you'll join us.
Acast helps creators launch, grow, and monetize their podcasts everywhere. Acast.com.